and you bend it, it breaks the chains.
Amen.
What's today?
Mother's Day.
You know that Mother's Day does not mean that you have to literally have given birth to someone to celebrate Mother's Day. Mother's Day is here to celebrate the ladies that served as mothers to all kinds of people. Amen? Have you ever served, before you even had a baby, did you have to ever serve as a mother to somebody? Amen. Some of us guys have served as mothers before. Yes, I don't, is it? All right, see him waving her hand back there. They turned off when I sing because they said I have a face for radio. That didn't even make sense, but praise God. Brother Keith said, that makes sense. Amen. So what we're going to do is, listen, there's a difference. You know, there's a lot of people that give birth, but they are mothers. Okay? Because the mothers actually, they actually never really, I mean, somebody gives birth does not mean that they actually have anything with the baby or even do anything with the baby. But a mother, somebody that actually has that mother instinct and she uses it, and it may be with other adults, it may be with whoever, but you use that mother instinct. I can tell just as good when that mother instinct's kicking in when somebody's helping me. I can tell it, I can feel it, I can see it. When that mother instinct's kicking in, praise God, I most of the time enjoy it. Most of the time. Sometimes I don't, because when they start acting like my mama, they start calling me David Clayton Linton, I don't want to hear it. All right, we need somebody. I mean, every lady in here is going to get something today. There's a pad, I mean a spoon. This multi-purpose comes from my family. That was a paddle first. Amen. Okay, we got something for all the ladies here. First, I want all the ladies to stand up. All of you ladies, stand up. And give them a hand. Give them a hand. All these ladies, amen, amen, amen. Now, the children have already gone back in the back, so I'm going to need, there's one. Come here, please. That's a fine-looking young man right there. Y'all better go ahead and enjoy him before Hollywood comes and gets him. Ma'am?
What, Gary, help?
Come on, Gary, come on, help. Yes, sir. Come on. Y'all better catch him before Hollywood gets him. While the autographs are still free, and then you got an Olympic champion coming up, so you better get his autograph while his are still free. He's going to be on a box of Wheaties, and he's going to be on a commercial or a movie or something. All right, so here's what we're going to do. Find all the ladies. I'm going to give you more than that. I want y'all to go ahead. How many can y'all hold at a time? All right, go start carrying them out. There you go. Can you get more? There you go.
There's two ladies in the back.
There's two ladies in the back. We got to carry them some too. And Dudley's standing in for Linda. He's playing mother today. I got to read the card too. The card says, "Mom, I must admit, you're one sweet cookie." Anybody else get one? God's good.
All the time.
How many more you need? Two? All right, you bout out.
Four.
Everybody got one now? Everybody got them now?
Two more.
There's
a whole basket full of them.
There. Oh, I see now. There's a basket. Y'all should carry a basket. A tisk and a task. These things are in a basket. There's two ladies in the back, too. Okay, how many more you need?
Down there.
Anybody? The 3 years off, Mr. Mom, I got Mother's Day and Father's Day gifts.
You can get one for Stephanie.
I got it.
Everybody got it?
Frank, yeah, I got hers.
Everybody's got one? If you don't have one, raise your hand. If you're a lady. All right, thank you so much. Zeke. Did everybody get one? Okay, we got a special treat for you today. No, that's not that special. If I cook those cookies, it's going to be special. Amen. When I was Mr. Mom, we prayed after we ate. DC and Daniel always had the most amazing ability to be gone after I cooked. I don't know what it was. They said, Daddy, you just cook out of a can, chef, all day, and all this other stuff. And I said, son, at least it's there. He goes, yeah, but so is too mean. Amen. Isn't God good? Hold on, there's some more of those technical difficulties. You always get those technical difficulties when you least expect it. Isn't that cool? DC's getting ready. DC, you got your microphone? Do not change your channel. We got two special treats. All right, here's the first one. Okay, DC, you ready, buddy? Yeah, that DC, not this DC.
Say it wrong.
come out and tell you, you look good in orange. I go back in F block. There's 50 guys. These are the, this is the prison of the prison, the lowest of the low, so to speak. They're the ones with the biggest crime, and they're the ones even serving life, and some of them. And so Doug and I go back there, and Doug's pushing the cart because he's the librarian. And I'm a librarian, but Doug was my assistant. We're going in. And I said, Doug, don't anybody touch the cart. If they touch the cart, they can't do that. You have to give this to them. They cannot touch the cart. And so first off, I walked by there without even thinking about it. I grabbed one of the guys and Doug and said, did anybody tell you look good in orange? And Doug said, didn't we just talk about this? We go a little further and the guys start crashing the cart. And without even thinking about it, there's little windows, darkened out windows up at the top. I didn't think about it. I said, did you see that laser pointed at your chest? And all of a sudden, all the guys backed off the car. I didn't want to tell them out that it was no laser, because then I would have been just, I just said, come on, fellas, they're not going to get you now. Come on. So you got to watch Doug when you take him back there, because he makes you do some crazy things. Yes, Lord, yeah. That was bad too. Okay, we were praying. And while we were praying, all these guys are praying, I was trying to say pray for the families. Instead of praying for the families, I said, pray for these guys' husbands. And Doug's going. Okay, here we go. Mark chapter 14. After 2 days was the feast of Passover and the unleavened bread, and the chief priests and the scribes sought how they might take him by craft and put him to death. But they said, no, not on the free feast day, lest there be an uproar of the people. And being in Bethany at the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at meat, there came a woman having an alabaster box of ointment of spikenard, very precious, and she broke the box and poured it on his head. And there were some that had indignation within themselves and said, why was this waste of the ointment made? For it may have been sold for more than 300 pence, that's a year's wages, and given to the poor, and they murmured against her. And Jesus said, let her alone. Why trouble you her? She hath wrought a great work on me, for you have the poor with you always. And whensoever you will may do good, do them good, but me you have not always. She hath done what she could. Y'all say that. She has done what she could. I can't say that one enough. She has done what she could. So let's see. Let me get ahead. She has come beforehand to anoint my body to the burying. Verily I say unto you, whosoever this gospel shall be preached throughout the whole world, this also that she hath done shall be spoken of for a memorial of her. Such for the hands this way. Father, we love you, Lord. We praise your name. We thank you for your grace and your mercy. We know, God, that you're alive and well. And we know, God, that your hands are upon us, God. Lord, this service today is not service as usual. I know it's Mother's Day, and I know there's some that would be here, but they're with their mother somewhere else, and there's others that have other reasons, whatever the reasons are, God. You know how to touch them, Lord, and to bless them where they're at. Lord, I ask you right now, Lord, to be that blessing to so many people right now. Lord, help us, God, to see, to know, and to understand that you have got this, God, and that you know what you're doing. In the name of Jesus, we pray. The church said,
Amen.
Amen. You can be seated. The woman who did what she could. The woman, say it again, the woman who did what she could do. Now remember, last week we talked about all the clamor, we talked about all the noise, we talked about how Martha was getting so upset, and we see how Mary was just sitting at his feet. You're thinking, well, she's just sitting at his feet. Well, that was enough just to hear his word, but not only was she sitting at his feet, then she gets a revelation of really who he is, and as she begins to get this revelation, she takes it to the next step. And I actually started to name this the next step from last week, because this goes right into it, and the book of John tells us that it was Martha and Mary and that this happens right here when she anoints Mary anoints her head with oil. So here we go. This has been difficult days for Jesus, okay? Very difficult for him. Oh, look at that. Look at this. Watch this. I love this. You know what that is? That's a bunch of mothers. Mothers, over the years, I've met a lot of mothers. And as I've met mothers, there's one thing I've learned. Watch this. Every one of them are unique. They're like a pearl. They're like a snowflake. You got in Mighty Army this morning, you saw, so I said, mothers are like snowflakes. They're unique. So today, instead of celebrating or instead of complaining about their flaws and pointing out their flaws is what we so do so good. For all people, we can point out a person's flaws so easily. But instead of pointing out your mama's flaws, not just today, but every day, but especially today, instead of pointing out her flaws, how about celebrate her uniqueness? Because you've only got one mama. One. Okay? And what she did for you and what she's done for you and the sacrifices that she made, just carrying you was enough. But then all the things she did along the way. So no two are just alike. But not only are no two of them just alike, every one of them, here's where they are alike. When it comes to getting something done for the family, I like this. I remember John Wayne saying, a man's got to do what a man's got to do. Y'all remember that, John Wayne? One day D.C. was messing up really bad. He was about 10 or 12 years old, 10 years old, maybe a little younger. Oh, yeah, probably a little younger, maybe 8. He's sitting there, and his mom says, why'd you do that? And D.C. said, well, Mom, a man's got to do what a man's got to do. And she said, come in here in this back room. He said, why? Because she said, a mama's going to do what a mama's got to do. Amen. What I've noticed about mothers is they will do whatever they have to do to get the job done. And so now that I've said that, because the Bible never tells us about Mary Martha's motherhood. So I'm not going to go there. But remember, you don't have to have a child to be a mother. To be a birth mother, you have to give a child or have a child. But to be a mother, there's a lot of people who never had children that are mothers and fathers. And so here we go. So watch this. It's tough days. It's dark days for Jesus. Jesus knows that he's getting ready to go to the cross. Matter of fact, let's just kind of do a little outline here. The leaders, they were plotting his death. He raised Lazarus from the dead, and they were trying to figure out, good Lord, if he raised Lazarus from the dead, we have got to do something. Well, we can't kill Lazarus, let's kill Jesus. And so they're going after Jesus, trying to find a way to kill him. They're going to the apostles and trying to get the apostles to give in and help them on this plot. And so he was surrounded not only by these guys, but he was surrounded by critics, and he was surrounded by his enemies. And so in his last hours on earth, he found comfort through fellowship with people that he loved. You know, a lot of times I can be having a bad day, I can be having a bad time, and D.C., I'd clear blue sky, I'll call me, or I'll call D.C. or Daniel or something, I call one of them, and back in the day when Bethany was alive, Bethany had this way of knowing, she could sense it, she'd come up, put her arm around me and say, come on, Daddy, what's going on? Come on, let's go ahead, then it's going to be okay. And so it's amazing how I can be feeling bad or feeling the pressure, and all of a sudden when I'm called, and all of a sudden I don't feel that pressure anymore. So Jesus was no different than us when it came to being a man. He was 100% man. Y'all say 100% man. 100%. He was 100% God, or he would not have had the price. But he was 100% man, or he would not have been able to pay the price. Because divinity was what had to have the price, but humanity is what it took to die on that cross. And so now, we're watching this. Now this is so powerful right here. Here's this woman. And she sees the stuff that's going on, and she understands there's something special happening here. She's at his feet. She is worshiping him. She's listening to him. Martha's running around like a chicken with her head cut off, about to have an emotional breakdown. And instead of her having an emotional breakdown, she's at his feet. She's listening to him. She hears what he's saying. And then it occurs to her, now I need to show him an act. I need to let him know just how much I love him. I need to let him know that somebody out there, there's more out there other than the ones trying to kill him and to criticize him and to hurt him, there are some people out there that still love him. So the first thing is, she did what she could with what she had. And I want you to think about this. Now, I'm going to read this, and I want you to watch this, because a lot of times, I just let the sermon speak for itself. And being in Bethany, he was at the house of Simon the leper. As he sat at meat, there came a woman having an alabaster box of ointment, a spikenard, very precious. And she broke the box and poured it on his head. She did what she could do with what she had. You know, I hear people all the time. There are people come up to me. People are good at picking out problems. You know, this is a problem at the family. There was a problem here. This is the problem. Even in church, there's a problem. You know, if we can do this or do that. But then I say, okay, well, if you want to say this is a problem, then why don't you spearhead it? Why don't you find a way to get it done? So I always hear this all the time. Think of what they would do. Their life is shattered or overwhelmed with what if. You know, I tell people all the time, and they go, what if, what if, what if? And I go, well, if bullfrogs had wings, they wouldn't butt behind you every time they hop. And they go, yeah, that makes sense. And I said, the other day I was getting my car inspected, and the guy was going to charge me arm and leg to do something. I said, you ain't got to do all that. I said, that's not how. He said, well, what if? I said, well, I said, if candies and nuts were ifs and buts, we'd have Christmas all year round. He said, well, tell me what you want. I showed him. And instead of $50, it was $3. People are always talking about what they're going to do. Their life is always full of what if. Now, then there's others that complain about what others do. They don't want to get off their seat of do nothing, but they just sit there and complain about what everybody else does. That happens in work. That happens in family situations. That happens in church situations. They just complain about what others do, and their life is always overshadowed by why them. Well, why not? If they're willing to do something, let them do it. You know, with Bethany's dedication of the night, I honestly just thought it was going to be a tree and a bench to set it. That's actually what I thought it was going to be. I didn't know it was going to be all they got going on there. It was amazing. But they just came to me at the men's office and said, look, we want to do something for Bethany, but we need your permission. I said, what is it? And they said, we want to put Bethany a prayer garden out there for everybody else to come out and remember Bethany, but also have a place to have counseling and a place to have meditation. I said, sure. They said, is it okay if we put a bench out there? I said, sure. And they said, is it okay if we put a tree out there? I said, sure. And then I just turned around and said, look, it's okay. Whatever you want to do is fine. Because I know you love her, and you're not going to make something out that's going to look bad. Just do what you're going to do. Just, it's okay with me. I promise you, it'll be fine. I didn't know they were going to. If you ever go to Camp Caroline, you'll see it. It's amazing what they did. And I meant to put it up here. I have to put it up next week and show you. But again, some people complain about what others do. Their life is overshadowed by what them. And then some people complain about what others don't do. And all you hear from them is, why not somebody else? Why can't somebody else do this? Why can't somebody else do that? You hear it all the time. And sometimes, I used to hear that at Fountain all the time. And I felt like sometimes, honestly, at Fountain, I didn't feel like I was an engineering manager. I felt like I was a day school coordinator. People have all reasons why they don't do something in their life or do something especially for God. But the Bible says, watch this, she did what she could do with what she had. I want you to understand something about this spikenard now. Now look, this woman did something. Watch this. Watch this now. Watch. She first off sought out of her best. First thing. She sought out the best thing she had to worship Jesus with. Now you got to understand something here. Spikenard is very rare. It comes in very small quantities. It takes a lot to get a whole bottle of spikenard. This spikenard, this spice, it winds up, they take it and they put it in this alabaster box. In this alabaster box, it's sealed. So it will not leak and it'll stay there for a long time. The people often got it for their own burial when they die. And so this is, This is some of the ways they embalm people was with this fighting artist. So here's this bottle, very expensive. It was on the minimum worth a year's salary. When Judas said, why wasn't it sold for 300 denarii? Again, a year's salary. She had this. A lot of times people, when they had this, they put it up on a shelf, and it wound up being something in the house that they treasured. It was something that they had in their house that they loved. When they saw this, they knew that it was going to be taken care of when they died. They had all this taken care of, and it was just something special about it. So, she knew the best thing in her house was this spikenard. So she sought it out, and she counted out. She knew how much it cost. She bought it. Didn't say if it took her years to buy it. Some people it take them years to buy this. But she had this spikenard in this sealed alabaster box, or a sealed alabaster vase. It was sealed. Once, the only way to get to it was to break it like a piggy bank. You had to break it. And once you broke it, you had to use it because you couldn't save it. It was over. You opened up that big old, that box, and here it is. It just pours out. She had thought all of this. But here she is. Jesus had been filling her and feeding her and ministering to her. And now she wants to minister to him. So she sought out. She got her best. She counted out. The cost was amazing. And then she gave out freely. Let me just go to the book of John. Let's go to the book of John. Y'all turn to John chapter 12. John chapter 12. Then 6 days before the Passover, verse 1. Then Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany, where Lazarus, which had been dead, whom he raised from the dead, they made him supper, and Martha served, but Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him. Then took Mary, a pound of ointment of spikenard, very costly, and anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair. You have to see all this now. This is something powerful. And the house was filled with the odor of the ointment. Then said one of the disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, which should betray him, why was not this ointment sold for 300 pence and given to the poor? Then he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the bag and bear what was put therein. Then Jesus said, let her alone. Against the day of my burying has she kept this. For the poor always you have with you, but me you have not always. Much people of the Jews therefore knew that he was there, and they came not for Jesus' sake only, but that they might see Lazarus also, whom they had raised from the dead. But the chief priests consulted that they might put Lazarus also to death, but because of that reason, many of the Jews went away and believed on Jesus. Now I want you to see something here. As she's doing this, this again, it just blows my mind because, watch this, she breaks. It's her most prized possession. Probably took her years to get it. She breaks the seal. And the way you break the seal is to break the alabaster box. When you break the alabaster box, it cannot be put back together. This ointment, she put on Jesus. And the Bible said the whole odor, this wonderful fragrance, filled the room. And then she took her hair. Look at the position. She went to his feet, the position of a servant. And she took her hair, a woman's glory, and she wiped his feet. Wow. And Jesus said, look, she did what she could do. Wow. Can you imagine what life for us would be like if we could do what we really could do for God? Wouldn't it be amazing? You You see, also, get ready to close. She did what she could do while she could do it. Because the Bible says he's getting ready to die. He's getting ready to go to Jerusalem. I have noticed, and it's not just our churches, every church has this problem. Some have it worse than others. And that is, I have noticed that the church is paralyzed by procrastination. How do I know procrastination exists? Because there's always somebody that's going to do something sometime. We have a lot of great tomorrow people. And I hear people all the time, I'm just waiting for the right time. I started putting somebody's arm in, I decided not to. But listen to this. Once I read it to you, you'll understand. A good plan, violently executed today, is better than a perfect plan tomorrow. General George Patton. Whenever they wanted something done, they gave it to him. And guess what happened? He done it. He got it done. She did what she could do while she could do it. There's a statement that Bethany made before she died. And this statement has wound up, I can't say haunting me, but it just stays in my mind all the time. After she was told that we're putting in God's hands, we're going to stop the treatment, she said, "Am I dying, Daddy?" And I said, "I can't say you're dying, but I can say that we can't treat it anymore because it'll kill you to treat you. We're just going to treat the pain." And she was going in and out. And DC, I think you were there too when this happened. But I know that she told Daniel, so I think it was Daniel at DC, she said, "I thought I had more time." Were you in there, son, when she said that? "I thought I had more time." That punches me in the gut. Every day. God, am I going to do something sometime? Am I going to do it tomorrow? Am I waiting for the right time? I hear it. Am I kidding? Every day. I thought I had more. Too many times. We see something needs to be done in our life, in our family, in our jobs, in church. And we keep pushing it off for some time, tomorrow, for the right time. See, this woman, here's what happened. She saw the opportunity. And again, I don't know if she was a mother at the time. I have no idea. Come on, everybody. There it is. She saw the opportunity. She seized the opportunity. She secured the opportunity. It's like all this now. When I've been talking for years about going and finishing this degree and getting SACS accredited, because all my stuff, the Bible I had was SACS accredited, but the counseling stuff was all is Christian accredited, and the state doesn't always accept that. And so I was thinking, you know what, 30 hours, I'll have it done, I'll have another degree. I called them up, they said, "Yeah, 30 hours, you'll have another degree, you'll be in counseling." I said, "Cool." Well then, once I get in there, and I start looking, after I've already enrolled, I've already done one of my classes, I've already done two psychologies, I start looking and say, well, I must be getting close to the end now. I look up there and I say, I got to do 60 hours. And I said, what happened to the 30 hours. And so, that's right, 30 hours. I said, but you just said I got to do 60. And said, well, we forgot to tell you, you got some core stuff that's got to be done too. And I said, but I just turned in all these hours. They said, yeah, but we're going to take some of them because they timed out. Your class is timed out. I was really upset until I talked to a professor that I knew personally, and the professor told me, said the same thing happened to him. He went back to school. He's getting his doctorate. While he's getting his doctorate, he stands all his classes and tries to hand them in. And And instead of them counting them as credit, they counted them as credit for hours, but they didn't count them toward the course because they said they timed out. They said, well, at least it's not just a game. This is the true thing. That's what I'm thinking about. This started in 2015. Still been taking all these classes. 36 hours of psychology, sociology, leadership, all this stuff. Right now I'm doing my fifth theology course. I'm going, good God, Lord, and all I keep hearing after Bethany died was, I said, now I can get this later. I'll get it later. I'll do it later until I hear Bethany said, I thought I had more time. So you know what I do? I go home every night. I do homework. Because I don't know how much time I got. I know I like to see when in my obituary that I had this, I completed this degree from Lee University. I want to see that. I want to see it good. You know, because, again, I don't want to die on my tombstone and say, I thought I had more time. So now, watch this. She did what she could do regardless of the critics. There's always going to be somebody criticizing you. It doesn't matter. They were saying, why didn't she sell this and give it to the poor? Why didn't you just take this and use it for why? Anybody's going to criticize you. I guarantee you, no matter what you do, somebody's going to criticize you. If you don't have somebody criticizing you, then the problem is you're not doing anything. We always have critics. Amen? So watch this. I'm getting ready to close. I told y'all I would. I promise you, three things in your life. Number one, there's always going to be critics. Number two, there's always going to be a chance. And number three, there's always going to be a choice. Get your Bible quickly. Quickly. I told you I'm closing. I am. My book's open, but I'm closing. See, this isn't like a standard Mother's Day presentation. I know it's not, but this is, I just couldn't believe this fell right in from last week, and I just couldn't, I just thought this had to be it. 1 Samuel 15. Saul was chosen to be the king of Israel. I want you to see this. That's why I told you to turn there. Please turn there. If you mark your Bible, mark this. Put a circle around it. As Saul was losing his kingdom, Saul said unto Samuel, I have sinned, for I have transgressed the commandment of the Lord and thy words, because I feared the people and obeyed their voice. 1 Samuel 15. 24. I'm sorry, I swooped over where you can see it. There it is. 1 Samuel 15, 24. Saul was told to go to Agag, take out Agag, take out all these guys, take out Agag the king, go to Amalek, destroy the king, destroy all the stuff, all the people, everything, just destroy it all. But the Bible says in verse 21, but the people took of the spoil, sheep and oxen and the chief of things which they should have utterly destroyed to sacrifice unto the Lord thy God at Gilgal. And Samuel said, hath the Lord a great delight in burnt offering and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? It's better to obey than to sacrifice and to hearken than the fat of the rams. For obeying is as the sin of witchcraft and stubbornness, as iniquity and adultery. Because I have rejected the word of the Lord, he hath rejected thee from being king. And Saul said unto Samuel, I have sinned, for I have transgressed the commandment of the Lord and thy words, because I feared the people and obeyed their voice. He had critics, he had a chance, he had a choice, and his choice was to move toward his critics, to shut them up. I promise you, you will never shut up your critics, ever. Now look at 1 Samuel 17. You ain't got any room to turn there. You can turn one too, but I'm just going to tell you what happened. The Bible says that David come up, done what his daddy told him to do, come up and feed his brothers who were in battle. And when he gets there, he finds out about Goliath. And for 40 days and 40 nights, Goliath has been doing his thing and threatening God's people. And nobody wants to go up there. And when David goes up and tries to find out about it, people start criticizing him. When he says, I'll go, his brothers start criticizing him. Everybody's criticizing him as he's going to go fight the giant. He says, who is this guy, this uncircumcised Philistine, this guy that's not of the covenant? I am of the covenant. I took on the bear and the lion, and I'll take on this giant, just like I took on the other two with God's help. The battle's not mine, but it's God's. He didn't listen to the critics, and he took out Goliath. Let me ask you a question. Who are you listening to? Who's shutting you down? That's the better question. Who's shutting you down, and who's building you up? Pay careful attention. And then finally, watch this, and I'm getting ready to close. I told you I was, I promise. DC, get ready because, and BJ, get ready. Here we go. Last slide. She did what she could for Jesus. Turn back to Mark chapter 14. I know it's been kind of slow today, but that's okay. We want it slow. The Bible says, first off, her motive was right. Because Jesus said, let her alone. Verse 6. Why are you troubling her? She hath wrought a good work on me. For you have the poor with you always. And whenever and whensoever you will, you may do good to them. But me, you don't have me always. She had the right motive. Her act was unselfish. Verse 3. In having an alabaster box of ointment, spikenard, very precious, she broke the box and poured it on his head and on his feet. And she acted out of compassion. She had done what she could do. She has come beforehand to anoint my body to the burial. I'm going to say something about that in the close. And then finally, she set a good example. He said she's done a good work, and it's going to be talked about everywhere. And she was rewarded for this. He said, wherever the gospel's preached, we're going to talk about this. And let me just talk about this fragrance. Because this fragrance was on his body, can you imagine? When he goes to be whipped, go in the garden and get him. Remember, when she anoints him, it says the fragrance filled the air. Come on, guys, get ready. The fragrance filled the air. Just a few days, he's going to be in the garden praying. And I can hear it now, the guards, when they walk in to get Jesus and looking for Judas, they're going, what's that smell? Wow, what is that smell? It's beautiful. It's that fragrance of worship, that spikenard. When they take him and they put him in and they interrogate him and they start pulling out his beard and slapping him, I can hear another guard going, what's that smell? Even when he's stripped and carried to the cross because that stuff got in his skin. On the way to the cross, I can hear him when he walked down the street, somebody go, what's that smell? That smell was Mary anointing him ahead of time for his burial. Wow. Let me ask you a question. Are you waiting for the right moment to do something? You waiting for the right time? You waiting for somebody to push you forward? Yesterday, Linda and I went to the Greenville Airport, and there's a thing called Free to Be Me. And we signed up little kids that had chronic diseases. We were there to help sign these kids up. Yesterday was just amazing because we were there for hours, signed them up so they could fly helicopters and fly airplanes. And there was all little games and stuff there. And so we were taking care of the kids. There was a bunch of volunteers. And as we left, there's these people from Georgia, and their car won't crank. And then they looked at me and said, you think y'all ask him, does he need a job? And so I went and asked him what was going on there. And we stayed with him for an hour, got his car running. And being an hour behind what we were planning to do, we go into Starbucks, she don't want any, I do. And we sit down there, and there's a guy that was at that thing yesterday. I get talking to him about he's a police officer in Greenville. And he's serving God, and he's trying to do things for God. As we get talking, I pull up a little stool and sat down, and I weren't trying to do anything, I'm just talking. And he stopped and he said, talk to me. Talk to me. Talk to me. And so we're going at it, we're going back and forth and talking, and he said, man, he said, this has been so refreshing. And you know what? He got his first Mighty Army this morning. He got a Mighty Army. But then as we left that place, we go to another place and we wind up ministering to somebody else, and then trying to get home and stop and minister to somebody else. And it was just constant. Wherever we stopped, there was somebody to come up and minister. So yesterday was a whole day of just ministering to people. And I honestly believe that God had all these people lined up, and all the timing was perfect. And number one, if we hadn't gone to that child thing, we never had any of that opportunity. But after going to helping those little children get in helicopters and airplanes, as we go to eat, matter of fact, the simplest thing was, as we're leaving the airport, the guys that were fueling the planes, I said, did y'all get anything to eat? And they said, no. I said, why do y'all want it? I said, they have hamburgers. You want a hamburger? And they said, sure. And so I said, I'll be right back with them. They got there and the hamburgers weren't there. They weren't having hamburgers. And so as we were leaving, Linda pulled into Hardee's and got two hamburgers. She said, you go back and get them guys what you said you were going to give them. And I went to give them, and they said, bless you. And I said, I've already been blessed. Then we go to eat, and in this guy, after we eat, here's the guy. Broke down from Georgia. And one after another, after another, after another, and after another. And I honestly believe if I'd have walked by and said, look, he can get help, and we can't help him. I'm not a mechanic, whatever. But instead, we stopped. Not making excuses. And here's what I told him. He said, I'm not a mechanic. I said, I'm not either, but I will do what I can do. And there's a servant. She did what she could do. And God just kept putting people left and right. They were all, it was just amazing. Yes, that was amazing. But it all started with, I mean, I go, well, God, the time ain't right. Can't you get somebody else? Can't you find somebody else? I'm really tired, God. Can't you do this? Can't you do that? No. All day long, every time I got stopped, I could hear a voice saying, you're stopped here for a reason. My time is perfect. And then here come the other person. Here come the other person. Here come the other person. God's got this. God's got this. And I brought several of these God's got this and put them in my pocket. And I had no idea. Linda said, what you doing? I said, somebody's going to get these. And I have no idea. And so police officers are wearing these in green. God's got this. Team Bethany. It's amazing to me. And the police officer cried when I gave him. And he hugged me. Again, all day long. I could have easily said, God, I'm tired. I just want to go home. I got a lot of homework to do. I got a sermon to work on. No, it just kept on and on. What turned out for a couple hours wound up being 7 hours. But you know what? So many people were touched, including me. And when I went to bed last night, I had that satisfaction of knowing, God, I don't know if I can all have today. I just know that I did what I could do. Everybody stand. I've yet to see a mother that won't do what she can do. She'll do it. She'll do it. This isn't your average Mother's Day sermon, but this is a continuation of last week. get deeper if we just keep refusing to do what we can do. You gotta do what you can do. And once you do, God will start doing what you cannot do. And it's amazing. It's amazing. With every head bowed, every eye closed. Nobody looking around. Here's what I want you to do. This is kind of a different altar call, but here's what's going to happen. Close. I want you to be honest. I want you to put your hand up. Your answer is yes. How many in here want to see God move stronger in your life? Raise your hand. You want to see God do more in your life? Raise that hand. Okay. Here is the catch. Before you see God helping you do what you can't do, you first got to do what you can do. Now, if you're willing to do what you can do, I want you to put those hands up again, both of them, and hold them up. I'm going to do what I can do. Lord, I'm going to do what I can do. I don't understand it all. It don't always feel pleasant. But God, I'm going to do what I can do. Lord, you see these hands? They're up. They want you to use them. God, they're willing to do what they can do. Open the doors so they can start doing what they can do. And as they start doing what they can do, you're going to show them that now, once they do what they can do, that you're going to start doing what they cannot do in their lives. And it's going to be an amazing transformation. When they leave this place, if they will do what they can do when they leave this place, they'll never be the same. Ever. 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 Lord, in the name of Jesus, bless them all. Use us mightily. Let this day be a very powerful day that goes down in our memory and in our hearts. That I will refuse. Y'all say this with me, God. I refuse not to do what I can do. And God, I can't wait to see you do in my life what I can't do without you. I thank you for this. I will never forget this day. I want to get married. And I want to let you use me.
Help us enjoy our mothers while they're still here to enjoy. And with you.
pray. Amen.